Can start.
So, good morning, everyone. Welcome to Siteco User Group India. Today we have Nelson with us, who work as a solution architect at Horizontal in our Dubai office. Today's session is about Siteco Search Crawler and API. So you will get the insight how it works and what are the APIs available. So more to come from the session. Hope you will enjoy it and learn something new. Nelson, over to you.
Sure. Thanks for the introduction, Kushbu. Welcome, everyone. So the first thing is like we're going to talk about Siteco Search and its users and how we're going to integrate using API and the other ways. Okay. So about myself, Nelson, solution architect from Horizontal. This is my LinkedIn and it's a blog post which I recently wrote. Okay. The agenda of this session is like the introduction of CEC, which is the where we actually do all our configurations and everything, and kind of attributes like attribute creations, like the fields. Basically, you need to index the documents. So what are all the fields which need to be created and assigned to the relevant documents? So those things really comes in the attribute creations. Widget is the one basically like we'll be creating different search components, like preview components or recommendation components or some things. So basically everything works as a widget in the Siteco search. So that's, we'll see how we're going to configure the widgets and the global level settings. So we can assign the global level settings for the entire widgets in the entire Siteco search. Instead of applying to the individual widgets, so we can go with the global level widgets. Finally, the source and crawlers, which is very important. So we'll see like how we're going to use source and crawlers to crawl the documents. API explorers, again, like it's a kind of inbuilt a kind of swagger. You can think like a swagger kind of thing, but yeah, we can directly use our inputs over there and can see the results over there itself. And finally, like how we gonna do with the help of the GitHub project, which is available by the community. So we can see like how easy it is able to get started with that. Okay. So that's the basic agenda of this session. So as I told, like the first thing is the CEC. You could see like we have a lot of things to be configured in CEC, which is attributes, domain, widgets, everything, whatever necessary for the Siteco search, which we able to configure in the CEC. So as you guys already aware, like this product is actually came from the Discover. So initially there was a product that Siteco purchased that product and they renamed it as Discover. That is purely used for the commerce application. Then they thought of using it for the content search instead of product. So they come up with a Siteco search, which is again built on top of Discover only. So most probably if you see the API somewhere, you could see Discover many places because they're still under the hood. They're actually using the Discover APIs itself. So this is the overview of the Siteco search infrastructure. So let's see one by one of our attribute creations and all those things right now. Okay. So let's get into the portal itself. So yeah. So basically, like this is our Siteco portal Siteco search dashboard. So so we need to get an access to this portal first of all. Like again, there is some basically if you already work with XM Cloud environment, like we have like a Siteco Cloud portal which has a separate login for Siteco search. This is an entirely different login, so there is no connection between that login and this login. So that again we actually as a Siteco team to provide a unified login, like how they provided for Siteco Connect and other SaaS-based product. So this is something it's in the air view. So basically, like once you get the access from your organization, so basically you will be having two information, which is very, very important for us to communicate with any kind of APIs and anything. So which is like your domain ID and your customer key. So which will be always available here, company ID, so and the domain ID. So based on that one only, you can able to communicate with the API to access the data, to crawl the information from Sitecore search. Okay, that's very important. So this is the basic dashboard structure. So this is the basically the analytics dashboard. So where we will be having like all kind of details, like this everything's are events basically. So what are all the things I'm performing on the website which is using the Sitecore search? Basically, if I'm trying to click any kind of search or any action I'm performing on the widgets. So every events will be tracked here, which exactly it is listed over here. Okay. So the main, these are all the main configuration tool. Let's go to the administration configuration tool. As you see, there is a manage user. So basically, if you want to give access to the user, so again, first of all, if you want to give access to the user, that you should be in a tech admin role. So basically, there are multiple roles available, but if you want to give access, then definitely you should be in tech admin role. Normal admin role will not have multiple features. Okay, so we should be in tech admin role to do all kind of activities in the CEC. Okay, so you could see there is a domain setting. This is the exact place we will be configuring all our attributes and everything. Example, what is the attribute? Say for an example, you want to crawl employee details. Okay, so employee will have his name, its designation, its company information, its salary information. So if you want to get all this information from a third party system, and if you want to have that in Sitecore search, yes, we need to create these relevant fields in Sitecore search, and then once you created this field, then we can use any API which is expose this data, and using that API we can store as a document in Sitecore relevant to those fields only. So this is the exact place where we can create our fields. So if you could see here, let me cancel this one. Yeah. So once you click attributes, so this section, this screen will pop up here, and you could see like all the attributes which we created, and out of the box you are also having like couple many attributes would be available for us. Okay, so we can easily go here and we can create our attributes. Okay, so by default you could see like the content. So by default this is the default, and so basically all the documents are based on entities. Okay, so entities are root objects. Based on that only we will be creating all the documents. So by default content is out of the box which is created. So if you want to create a different content for a different application, yes, we can do that, but as of now I don't have access to that content creation, so I'm already using the out of the box entity only right now. So we can create an attributes, like it's very, very straightforward. Like we can just go ahead here and we can provide a name. Okay, this is just a display name. Okay, so basically this is the attribute name. This is what you're gonna target while you're retrieving any information from any APIs or any sitemaps or anything else. Okay, so this is the exact name, which is an attribute name, which is important. And data type is basically like what kind of a data you're gonna retrieve information from the API. So that's something we can able to provide this information, and a description as is just what exactly this particular things is doing. So as you could see, like this is the very very, very important field. If you provide this mark as required, then this field become mandatory. So if you say for an example, like the employee information doesn't have a employee name, and you have a name as a required, then this particular data will not get imported into Sitecore search, because that is a mandatory field. That data has to be passed in the API to us if you make it as a required field. And you could see there's a written in the API response, basically like what this means. So when we actually crawl this information, if you want to see the data like the dashboard or anything, this item, this field will be displayed for us in the dashboard and also in the API as a response. Okay, so I can show that one available for QClick. This is again from the CEC, whether this is able to view in the dashboard itself. Okay, so these are some of the details available here. And main important feature is this one, use for the features. Okay, so once you created any attributes, we can define whether this attribute can be used as a facet, whether this attribute is used as for a textual relevance or suggestion blocks. What do you mean by textual relevance is basically it's a kind of a search. See, I want to provide some search keywords, right? So in the search, basically, we will be doing like search like a keyword or something, keyword search, right? So if you want to make this particular field as a keyword search, then we need to enable this one. So then this field will automatically become as a keyword search field for filtrations. As I told, like facet is basically like you will be having like in the search, we'll having the right left side, you can see like a lot of checkboxes available with all the facets information. Exactly behave like that based on this particular field. Okay, so suggestion blocks is again like it's a recommendation things. So based on this field, it will provide some recommendation for us. Like if you do some searches, it will provide some recommendations. This is we are already configuring only in the field level. We are not doing anything with the widget level. That we will see how to do it at the widget level. So this is the basic information about the attribute creation. One thing I noticed is basically we could see there is one thing called image URL here, which is again a string field. This is out of the box came, but this is again a string field. So when I try to crawl the image from the database, like say for an example, the API, it is giving me image URL with JPG. But instead of using this particular field, if I using any other field, it is not giving me as an image. Okay, so it is giving me as just a string. But when I use the say this image URL, then it is actually giving me as an image. Okay, that I can show you how that looks in the wizard. Okay, so this is about the attribute sections. We just looked at the feature configuration. So basically, this is we did in the individual level attributes. Like we can go with the overall configuration level. So basically, we can see like these are all the fields which I created, and I want this attribute to be a facet. I can just go ahead and enable this one as well. So it's just like that. So these are all the couple of attributes I have enabled. So we can just go and edit this one. So we can do something like this. Okay. Okay. So we can enable all the fields like this. Like either you can have in the as the facet should be in ascending order, descending order from this field. We can still be able to do that as well. So these are all the couple of fields based on our configuration attribute. This will be automatically populated here, where you can just able to enable or disable accordingly. That can be possible here. Okay, again the same thing for we can go with suggestion block. So basically suggestion block is something, as I told, it's a recommendation thing. So what I'm trying to say, just give me data from this kind of attributes like description attributes and other attributes. So basically this if you have some attribute tagged as a feature in the attribute section, this will automatically drop down shows up for that. So we can just select from the configuration, what are all the combination you want. So something like we can easily able to handle this one. So the important perspective is the analyzer. So basically ng-gram is best way to use. So that's what the Sitecore search documentation everywhere suggested. But yeah, so that is where it's still configured that one to provide kind of recommendation or partial search or all kind of things. So that's basically how the suggestion blocks works. Textual relevance is again the similar thing. So as you could see, like I am just specifying like what all the fields need to be, like the keyword search fields. So from this field, if I do any searches based on this analyzer, this will able to provide us the details for us. Okay, so we can able to remove this attribute if we don't want to have this attribute to be textual searches. That's something we can able to handle this one. So yeah. So let me go to domain setup is something like so basically like we can able to have a domain setup. If out of the box we'll be having a default domain, but if you want to create a subdomain for our organization, yes, we can do that. That's purely like that one only. Yeah. So now we have created the attributes. So now we can go with the sources itself. Okay. So as you could see, like we have like different kinds of sources available. So this is the sources. So what do you mean by source? Basically, like when we want to crawl any content from the third party system, either in terms of they're exposing the data in API, they're providing the data in SOAP API. So again, we are not having any problem with crawling a data from the REST API or from the SOAP API. So most of the people still using the classic web services, which is ASMX file. So for the .NET people, so still that can be crawled here. I can show a sample of how that is working now. And API, REST API can also be crawled. Even we can crawl PDFs, we can crawl a Word document, we can even crawl RSS feeds and all those information. So Sitecore out of the box provided like couple of sources for us to crawl that information. So on clicking the create source button, so we will be having different types of connectors for us to crawl the in data. So you could see like we have API crawler. So basically API crawler is purely for like crawling the CAPs, like whether it's JSON REST API or something like that, we can go with this API crawler. But for now, like the web service API is not working here. So I actually used the one more API, which is this is web crawler advanced, which is the most advanced, and it does all the functionalities. So this is the one which have the full functionality, but other things are like splitted into a separate thing based on our needs. But this has all the features embedded here. So we have API crawler. As you could see, there is one more crawler called API push crawler. This is a different crawler from this one, advanced crawler. So what do you mean by API push is something? So until now, what we discussing is we gonna crawl the information from either like some API or PDF or something like that, right? So which is Sitecore search will automatically crawl this information from our side. But in case if you have any data in in Sitecore environment unpublished, you want to push that data to Sitecore search environment through webhooks or something. So in that case, we can still use this particular crawler. This is like something we have in full control. Like the Sitecore search will provide a web API for us. Using that web API, we can push the data to the Sitecore search environment. Okay, so it provides the code operation. We can add, delete, update the documents from the API itself. So this is exactly the push API, and feeds is basically RSS feed. And as I told, this is web crawler is the minimum thing, and advanced will be having all features basically. Okay. So as per, let's go here. Is that opened? Let me open this one. So we have checked attributes and domains. Let's go through the widgets and pages now. So before that, I just want to talk about this crawlers, like API crawler and API push. Let's see a example for that, and we'll go to the widget and pages creations now. Okay. So here, like I'm just gonna give some example how we gonna crawl the data from the Sitecore experience edge. So using GraphQL endpoints and all those things. So I have a samples available readily with me, but I just gonna show like how we gonna create. But I can't execute right now because that will take like nearly 5 to 10 minutes to crawl those information. So I'll try to do the setup here, and I can show how that works. Okay. So I will be using this advanced web crawler here. So we can, or else we can still use the API as well, okay? Because this both will work in this case, okay? So if you want, we can go with this one as well. So we can go with like GraphQL edge. So description is mandatory, so I have to put description. So once we have created this source, we will be end up with getting this screen. So this screen has lot of information which need to be configured. The very first information here is like you could see this is the source information. So it has a source ID. Okay, this source ID is very, very important for us. So based on the source ID only, we will be generated the documents. Documents are generated to this particular source IDs. We could see like there's an API crawler setting. So there's a max depth is available. So this is very, very important. So in case if our API, for example, you have a page, okay, the page has a let me talk about the pagination itself inside CoreEdge. Okay, so basically in experience edge we have an item has childs as well, right? If you want to look through each child one by one and add those items to the sidecore search, then we need to provide this depth attribute. Okay, that means what is this depth attribute does mean? It will look for nested links, are basically something like that. It will go to the links internally and it will crawl the documents and it will store into the sidecore search. If you're not providing the maximum depth, if you provide just zero, it will not basically crawl the child information or any nested links in the document basically. So if you want to crawl any links inside that one, so better we can have the max depth thing. Okay, so the max URL is something purely for like, say for an example, I'm using a sitemap.xml file, right? Under the sitemap.xml file, like I will be having like thousands of documents, but I just want to crawl only 50 documents, then it will only crawl 50 documents. So if I want to crawl like more than 100,000 documents, yes, you can provide what are all the number of URLs it will go and grab the document, something like that, okay? This is again a parallelization. So basically how many parallel thread need to be work to retrieve this document. Okay, so as of now it's setting with one, but based on our CPU and based on our requirement, we can increase those informations as well. Okay, so that is the basic settings for the API crawler. So as of now, the max depth is 2, and I have like maximum 10,000 even out of the box schemes. And this is one important place we can target. This is the local. So what do you mean by local? Basically, like whether are we trying to get a document from English version, or if you want to get a different language versions. So we can create a different language version, which we can do that in. All right, somewhere here. Give me a second. Yeah, it's here. Yeah, so you could see like under administration panel, so we have a local section. We can go ahead and create our locally here. Okay, so in case if you want a different language level content, so by default you can create those information. So I just have like English and Arabic version here. So but yeah, we can still go ahead and create all the language details over there. Okay, so let me go to the source, which this is the one source I just created. I'm just going to click on that. So as of now, it is pointed to English version, but yeah, you can still go and edit if you want to go with a different language version, which will be this one, right? So it will automatically pop up for you guys, so we can able to select. But I don't need that one right now, so I'm just going to leave with the English version itself. Okay. So the other important point is the tag is just basically we are just setting like what kind, from which entity we gonna set. As I told, so we will be having the only one entity out of the box. So that's the entity tag, but if you have a different entity, we can still gonna change that one. So all the content is based on the entity only. So that entity is very, very important and mandatory field here. So the next three important section here, which is the trigger section, document extractor, and the request extractor. Okay, so let me go what exactly the trigger section is. The trigger section is basically like where you actually configuring the API endpoints and everything like that. So from where you want to grab the content from. So example, right now I'm going to do some trigger section. So as you could see, like this is a trigger section. I have JSS JS, JavaScript trigger, and as well as request trigger. So in case like if you want to grab any data from the sitemap XML, in the sitemap XML having like a lot of links, right? So I want to grab all the, go through all the URLs, and I need to grab all the data from that, then definitely we're going to use a request. Say for an example, if you want to call any REST API, again request. If you want to use any RSS field, is again request. If you want to use any GraphQL edge endpoint, again request. So basically, like more predominantly, we want to use the request endpoint here. So better we go with request here. Again, basically what, so basically the body attribute, right? Basically, if you put, since again, it looks exactly like we are using Postman here. So we can use a post attribute, and this is exactly where we're going to point our URLs. And this is the document, the object which we're going to pass. So sample, like if you're going to use the GraphQL endpoint here, let's take, let's grab that GraphQL endpoint here, which is this one. So I go ahead and put it here. And then I can have a headers here. Basically, this will be like content type, and this will be basically we should provide this content type. So this is important for it. Basically, the, it should work. And then we should have the GraphQL token. GraphQL this token as a key, and this is our dummy key. She can use this one. Again, the body is important, so I have some sample body here. Okay, so that's it. Like our endpoint has been created here, so I can save this endpoint. Okay, so now I have the endpoint setup is ready. So now what this will do, like it will try to crawl this crawl this endpoint based on the configuration settings we actually captured here. And it will grab the content. So now we have the content. So how we gonna get the content, and how we gonna place this content in some of the attributes which we just defined before, right? So that is where this document extractor comes. So document extractor, basically it will extract the content, and it will assign to the attributes, and it will create a document for us. Okay. So again, here we have a, in the document extractor also we have a different ways. Just we can provide a name here. So basically if I provide like a test edge crawler, so we can do that. And as you could see, like we have like a two different way to extract the content, which is JS, JavaScript, and JSON path. So what is JS? Basically, if you have any content which you can say, for example, let's take an example of a REST API, right? So you are actually crawling a data from a REST API. So the REST API will give me the structure in JSON only. So it is easy for us to crawl that with the JavaScript thing. Okay. Sometimes you will be crawling the content from the page DOM itself, like the web page itself, like a metadata or some description section in some HTML. Tag, strong tag or div tag or something. In that case, we can still go ahead and use the JSON path. So out of the box, so basically out of the box, Sitecore search is already provided with some out of the box information for us. How can we do that? So say for an example, like if you could see here, so if I'm selecting like JSON path has my document extractor type, so this tagger is very important. So this is where we actually specifying how to crawl this information and where this information. Okay, so example, like if you click here, this attribute, this is the attribute which we created in the attribute section. All the attributes I just created before, it will come up here, and I just need to select it here. So this is the image URL field I just showed before, and we can just select, like say for an example, this is basically an HTML tag, right? So basically we can select like like a div tag or something, so p tag text or something basically. So if I want to select a p tag or something, so basically this is how I can show a sample for that one. So this is exactly we can select. So what will happen, this will look from the p tag text and it will assign to the image URL. Okay, and if you want to set any default value, which we can provide a default value here. Okay, this is how the JavaScript the DOM extraction works. Okay, JavaScript also is a similar way, but here, so out of the box, the Sitecore search has already provided this basic snippet for us. So So using this one again, so it is also trying to crawl the information from the DOM only. As you could see, they actually trying to do crawling the information from DOM. But yeah, but we can still do, if we don't want to crawl DOM, we can still modify the code to crawl the information from any JSON document. Okay, again, I will show a sample for that one as well. So as you could see, this is the static, this is the common method. This is the method we should always be using. Only this place we can go ahead and change based on our thing. So basically, the request is basically what the request parameter we are passing. Like this request will have our request URL, HTTP method, and all this information will be available in this one. And response will be exactly what the response for this particular API request is came. So that we are assigning in the dollar attribute. From the dollar, we are just trying to get the content from the metadata description section. So, and we are assigning it to the description attribute, name attribute, type attribute, and URL attribute. Okay. So here, these two attributes are not mandatory. The three attributes are non-mandatory, but this type attribute is very, very important. So as you could see, like webinars or seminars, they are talking about like they can crawl multiple sources. Example, sitecore.com is crawling the source for information from different websites, right? Sitecore's they're having multiple websites, and so the XM Cloud, Sitecore Search, Order Cloud, CDP, and they are actually crawling the information from all these portals, and dynamically they're actually providing in the single facets in the sitecore.com, right? That how they actually doing it. Basically, they have created a separate sources for CDP, Order Cloud, and everything, and everything is created based on this type attribute only. So end of the day, this is the type where they specify whether this type is CDP or something like that. So if it is CDP, then all the information come from this particular document will be stored in term with CDP thing. Okay, so in the facet, when I want to look only for XM Cloud or CDP, then this only the information from these facets will be loaded. Okay, so the type attribute is very, very important. This will exactly tell us like from which source. So basically you can think it as a kind of a source filtration as well. Okay, so this is very, very important field. If you have multiple source and you want to filter the data, then this is very important. Okay, and as you could see, this document doesn't have an ID attribute. So ID attribute is also very, very important to uniquely identify the document. So So in case if you're trying to get a document from JSON, so ID is very, very important. So without ID, the crawler will fail. So we need to have ID attribute in case we are using for any JSON crawling something like that. Okay. So once we did that one, so that so now what will happen? So we actually trigger the request. So this will go to the edge endpoint and it'll crawl the information. And this is document extractor. We actually loop through one by one record from the edge, and we actually store it to the endpoint. Now we actually did that one. Okay. So but in case if I want to do a pagination or I want to do a child crawling, okay. So in that case, there is one more thing called the request extractor. So request extractor, basically it will create a further URLs for us. That means in the request trigger, I created only one URL, right, which is like the edge endpoint, right? But and also in the I also provided the give me a second, also provide the query like this one, like the layout query like this one. So I provide the path like the mobile path, right? So this mobile path will also have a sub children's, right? So I want to crawl that information as well, because this doesn't, I'm not querying here for child items. I'm just querying only for this mobile path only, right? So I'm not querying for any child item. So in case if I want to query for the child items, then I need to create the same query one more time. But with dynamically, I need to inject all the childs in this path, right? That's case, I can generate a request extractor that will go one by one to all the child paths, and it will create a URL dynamically, and that will do. So let me show that examples right away to you guys, okay? So which I have already have an example that when. So this is the layout query. Let's see, it has so you could see like, so this is a request extractor, and I have like the GraphQL query, okay, and we have the edge endpoint configured here. So let's go to the edge document extractor. So I using the JavaScript extractor. So as you could see, like this is how I'm extracting the content here. So as you could see, like this. So basically, when we having a layout service response from the edge endpoint. So this is how the structure will be. So right now, what I'm trying to grab the information is I'm trying to look from the particular placeholder. My placeholder is this mobile placeholder. So the structure will be remain for I think every application. This is the layout service, common layout service response. Okay, this will be always the same for anyone who is using Edge endpoint. So only thing is this placeholder might be different for everyone. And you could see like now I assign this response. I'm just checking the null check here, and then what I'm trying to do, I'm just looking for a particular component from this placeholder. So the placeholder have multiple components for me. So among the placeholder, I want grab the content from a specific component, which is this one, quick links. So from the quick links, again, it's a list for me. It's a kind of a quick links, the multiple links is available for me. So again, I'm looping through the particular component, okay, and I'm assigning to these fields. So this is basically, these are all the fields, okay. So as you could see, I have a link ID field here, and I have a type field here. This is very, very important, as I told. So again, this information is actually coming from this quick links component only. So I'm actually passing the this date the function parameter here, and then I'm just gonna get all this information to my document. Okay. So this is just how the document extractor grabs the content for me and how this works. Okay. So this basically the endpoint is what? This is Sitecore layout query, right? Okay. I'll show the results for that one, and it doesn't have a document request extractor. Let me show the request extractor quickly, but in the meantime, I'll show the content for that one. How the content. So once the document has been extracted, so we have one more place. This is the place where we can see all the content collections. So all the document which I have extracted will be available in this tab, which is content collection. You can click the content collection. So we can filter the document by the IDs. If you have any ID of this particular document, which is this one, or else we can still go ahead and see the sources here. So as you could see, this is our source name, which is Sitecore layout query. This is exactly we just seeing now. So as you could see, this is exactly I have grabbed the information from. So as I told now, this is a content type. So this is the display name. So the name which I'm passing is the attribute name in the actual field configuration, but this is just for display name, which I configured in the attribute section itself. So these are all the information I got the data from the layout service. And I'm just, for reference, I'm just adding the URL here as well. Okay. So this is how the GraphQL query works, grab the content from the layout service. Let me take you to the place where we can do the pagination. So I have two types of pagination available. So one is with so Edge also have its own pagination, which is cursor based pagination. So I have a sample query for that one, as well as if we want to query, we don't want to use the cursor pagination, but if you want to go with the child descendant level, like dynamically appending the item path, that kind of a pagination also available right now. So I can show those queries as well right now. So let me go here. This one is a trigger again. Let's go to the trigger. So as you could see, this is basically, let me copy this one and I'll show you what exactly it's there. So basically you could see like I'm just crawling the children here. Okay. So I will try to crawl the children from one particular path, one particular path. So I need to pass a path, right? So one item ID, I will be on item path I'm passing. From that item, I will be crawling all the children. So that is actually the query for me, the GraphQL query for me. So what my request document extractor will be like, straightforward, like how we did before. So what I'm just doing here is just I'm just looking for the item.children of that particular item. Okay. and then I'm just adding the content. Okay, so but the point here, what I'm trying to say is, if you want to loop, so nested level children's as well, right? So this is like in the GraphQL query itself, I'm just grabbing the children. But in case if I want to go with nested level children, that children will have one more children, that children will have one more children, right? So if you want to go that level, then this particular document extractor will not work. So because that level of query information we not provided, the path we are not provided. So that is where we are going to use the request extractor, as I told before. So let's see how I'm configured the request extractor. So this is the request extractor. So you see, like, this is exactly the same function like how the document extractor looks like. So again, I'm making the request object here. So we could see like so basically I'm just scrolling. Say for an example, I'm having a home item. Under home item, I'm having about us item, and about us item will having like some other item, and that item will have some other item. So it's going in nested like. So I'm first level children. I take the children, and what I'm trying to do, I'm just grabbing the method, what's the HTTP method. So this is always available. All the information of the request will be available here. So I'm just grabbing this one from there, and the URL also, which is the agent point, which is also been, I can able to grab from here. So I'm just trying to create one more kind of a trigger here. Okay, you can think it as a triggers, basically kind of a one more URL I'm trying to frame here. So now you could see like I'm just creating in URL object here. So let me copy this one. Sorry. So what I'm trying to do here, so I'm trying to grab the date. Again, I'm trying to get a children from which URL? From this path, dynamic path. So this dynamic path is coming from the previous results. So that is how we gonna do. So previously I have hardcoded the path, which is the static homepage path or something. Now under the homepage, I loop through the children and I'm get that path. And then again, I'm placing in the request extractor of that path. And again, now what will happen? This will create a query. Now this is the URL. This will generate a URL. So basically what will happen? So this, see, I'm just creating the results here. So all the request URL details will be collected as an array attribute, and then that will go to the triggers, and that will again trigger, and the document extractor will keep extracting the content. So basically, request extractor is not going to extract any content. This is just going to create the URLs. Okay, document extractor, the place where we're going to grab the content from, and the trigger is the initial setup of the URLs. I guess we got clear here. So this is not using the cursor pagination. I'm just using the child level, just dynamically passing the path to the GraphQL. I'm just getting the content from. Okay, so and again, as you could see, like I would have created the max depth equal to 2 and 1000, because if I try to put less than 0 or 1, it will not go into nested loop level. So it's better we can have, if you go into nested level things, better we have the maximum depth should be increased. Okay. So let's go and see how the data looks like for this one. So this is the source name is. Sitecore item paging, right? Okay, so let's go and see the content from here. So go to the content, like we can see that content here. I think this one. So as you could see, like we have all the this. See, I have provided only one path there, but you could see like I'm getting a lot of data from that, right? So this is because like it is going to one by one it dynamically creates a path. And it will crawl the data from the Sitecore XM Cloud using Edge. Okay, this is not with cursor pagination, normal path pagination. Yeah, so we can still open the item and we can see the information. So as of now, I have some dummy data there, so that's where it's coming up like this. But yeah, we can see like all the information which I'm passing there, which will be having here. Okay, now we can see how we're gonna use the cursor pagination. Which will be like this one, not that one. There's a lot of things we created. I think this one. Sorry, not that one. Did you check this one, right? API 8, sorry, this one. Yeah, this one. All right, let's go here. Let's see the request object here. As you could see, this again, this is a request object here. Let me go one by one again. Copy this one. So this is my request object. So I'm just trying to use a query, dynamic query. I'm just checking, like, this is basically, I'm using a search query here. I'm not using a normal layout query here. Basically, yeah, if I want to do a cursor pagination, so I should have used the, I should be using like the search basically. So I'm trying to use a search query here. So I'm just checking whether the layout is there or not for the particular item. And just, I'm providing the path from which path I need to grab the content from. And again, I'm just using from which template I need to grab the content from. Okay, and finally, like, I'm just setting like how many the page size, and I'm just grabbing all the cursor information and everything. Okay, so as you could see, like, I'm not doing anything different here. I'm just, my variables is null, nothing's there, but just trying to access the content from. Okay, now what I'm gonna do, basically, once I configure this thing, basically, again, the rest of the parameter will be still the same. Like, you could see GraphQL, the token, content type, the age, URL, everything would be remain same. Oh, the place where we're going to change is the request extractor. Even you can go and see the document extractor, it will remain same only. So let's go to the document extractor. We could see, like, see, again, what I'm trying to see, I'm trying to grab the content from the response object, which is this information. So again, so you could see there's a slight change in this the data here, because I'm using the search. So basically, the response from the search is kind in this format. Basically, the details are something. Again, what are the parameter I'm passing here? So that is how it will be coming up. So basically, what are the output response we are coming? I'm just getting those parameters in this format and just trying to grab this information from. Okay, so now again, once I got this is not null, so I'm trying to loop through those particular informations, and I'm trying to push. I'm going to create the document basically. So I'm just creating a document here, and this is just for reference purpose. I just created this end cursor, but yeah, that's not needed. But yeah, you can provide any other information from the fields, but just for my reference purpose, whether my if I want to use the cursor URL for me to directly check the edge endpoint directly whether my result is proper or not. So just I'm adding this as a field itself in the document. But yeah, it's not needed basically. Yeah, so basically here it doesn't need any. So I'm not doing any pagination here. As you could see, I'm not doing any pagination here. I'm just grabbing the content from the edge. I'm just adding it to the document here. That's it. I'm not doing anything here. And finally, I'm creating a list of documents, and this list of documents will be stored into Sitecore search. Okay, now I have did this one. Now, but what about the pagination, right? So now we can go to the request extractor, which I created here. So where you could see, like, I have created like a extractor here. I could show here. So as you could see, like, this is the request extractor I just created. Again, this first two lines will be always same for every place. The second line is basically like the array. Okay, I'm just creating array. This array will hold the URLs, what endpoint it need to call and what data it need to be passed to calling that endpoint. So all this information will be available here. So I'm just trying to create the endpoint here. So what I'm going to do here, what I'm trying to do here is basically I'm just checking here whether the this property is available from the edge only. So it is checking whether the page as any new pagination or not. So I'm just checking that one. If it is as, then I'm trying to see the end cursor is also not empty. Yeah, if it is that there, then I'm trying to create a endpoint URL with the information here. So you could see this is exactly the object I'm trying to create here. So you could see, I just need, see, basically when we do the edge pagination, we no need to do any changes. Only we need to do the cursor, just we need to append the cursor. That's more than enough. We don't want to touch any of the parameter, because this parameter is already same parameter which I created initially in the trigger. This is basically the template ID, sorry, the path, and this is the same template ID. This path is not dynamic. This can be still the home page. This can be still the same template, but this cursor is very, very important. This is where the pagination is happening. So I'm dynamically generating this the pagination cursor, which again I'm grabbing it from the response body only, which is coming from here only. I'm not creating any of my own cursor. Okay, this is already coming from the response. So what this will happen? This will be already in the for loop, right? So this will be in the loop. So this will be like push it to this request, okay, as an array. Then finally, what will happen? Once we did this one, so again, this will try to crawl this URLs one by one, and the document extractor will grab this content and it will be get indexed. So we'll see like how this data has been stored here. Let me see, this is APH, so APH as a source. Let's go and see the data here. So go to content here. So basically we have many things to filter it here. Okay, you can see the field level filtration as well here. Like, okay, you can see, I can see the content type filtration, or I can go with the source filtration here. So we have a lot of filtration available here. So I'm just going with the source itself. So as you could see, like these are all some of the data which I actually grabbed from this content itself. So let's take an example of this one. So as you could see, this is the cursor pagination URL. So I'm just, for reference purpose, just added it here, but still we have the name of the item and everything. So you could see the URL and everything is properly coming. So if you have any edge endpoint to crawl the data, so we can able to easily crawl this information from, okay? So this is how just edge crawling works. What's the time now? Oh, we have time. I think we almost there. Okay. I think like pretty much same. Basically, like we have. I just want to show. So basically, if you want to show, see the images and everything, I could show one thing here, which is this one. So if you could see some information here, right? So if you want to store image, right? Initially in the attribute section, I told you like there is out of the box image underscore URL field is there. So when we add that one, then the image is showing up. But when you try to use a different string field, the image is not showing up. So basically I can show how this I configured here. So as a quick, it is that API MVP. So basically this is a trigger here. So I'm just trying to get all the, so just the request trigger, get endpoint. I'm just grabbing this information from here. Okay. Document extractor is very, very straightforward. So nothing much there. So just normal here. Okay. Just what I'm doing, just using, this is the image URL. I'm just grabbing the information from this, the JSON document. In the JSON document, I'm just looping it here from, it's basically an array. So I'm just looping from the JSON document, and you could see this is the type attribute. So as I told us, type is basically the differentiation from the sources. Okay, so this is how the type attribute will be. So, you could, that's how it has been indexed here. Okay, so with the limit of time, let me go to quickly with the other things. Okay, we have like 2 minutes. Let me, if possible, shall I take like 10 minutes extra? Pushpo?
I think we can stay for 5-10 minutes.
Yeah, all right. So quickly, so we actually gone through this once, like this one. Again, PDF is again very easy. Like we in Sitecore, we can even crop, we can even crawl PDF. But out of the box, the PDF crawling is it's difficult. Basically, like we don't know the structure, but we can convert that structure into HTML first, and then we can even crawl that information. But we can do using third-party tool to convert that PDF into HTML. But Sitecore recommendation is don't do that one, because sometimes the DOM elements will be different and vary, so it will be different from the Sitecore to do that. So they actually, there's very small syntax available for that to convert the document into PDF, so that we can quickly see. So document extractor. So this is a tool. This is a tool, one line of code like this one. So basically, like they're just converting into HTML, basically. So that's it. And then now this HTML content is coming to us, then we need to create one more crawler which will grab, so which will which we can grab this information in some notepad or something, and we know how the HTML structure, then we can usually use the document extractor to extract the content from that particular PDF. Okay, so this is basically a PDF URL only. So you could see I would have created a PDF URL only, so online PDF URL request attribute only. Okay, so let's talk about the widgets quickly. So by default, like we having a different types of widget. We'll be out of the box. We having search widgets and the preview widget right now. So this will be this RFID is very very important. Based on this one only, the entire the page searching will works. Okay, so I will show a demo quickly on that one. And as I told, there is a global configuration available. That's something very important. That's what I want to talk about. So if you could see here, like there is a global widget settings here. So this is the place we actually targeting the entire global level settings. Basically, if I want this widget to work based on this particular search parameter, keyword, the field attributes. So here, for the textual suggestion, which means like keyword search, I am asking this widget to take from these fields, all these fields, okay? So which we can enable or disable, like I can exclude this one or I can include this one. So this field will automatically show up when I configure that in the attribute section. So attribute section is just for creating, but whether configuring it to the particular widget, just we can enable or disable it here. So once you enable this one only, when you do any search in the site, the search will work. If not, the search will never gonna work. Okay. So this kind of a setting on the widget level is very very important. So so again, we can do for facets and everything like this one. That's basically, and we have the, if you go to developer tools, we have like a lot of information available, like so if you want to crawl this information, if you want to push the data from a third party system to Sitecore Search through push API, then we can have the keys here. So we have this is push API is called ingestion API. We can grab the key from here and we can do that one. And this is the API Explorer. I'm just going fast. Okay, this is API Explorer. This is the pages. So we actually created the widgets, right? Each and every widget will be assigned to some pages. Okay, so that pages basically it will be available here. You could see like these are the home pages and these are all the widgets we have actually assigned to it. So it's again straightforward. We can create the page and there is an option. We can have a widget option that we can assign that one. So once we did that one, so we can go add, we can do the search from here. So basically, if you put any parameter here, so let me show you a quick example here. I'm not going to do the entire thing, you know. So let me build this one. So as you see, like once I put all the parameters here, once I build this one, I click run, it will provide me the response directly to me. Okay, so this is how we gonna do the API in the portal itself. We can see whether my APIs works, whether my search works, and everything. We can quickly check here. Okay, so let me go to one small thing, which is I just want to show how the push API works. Basically, that means the Sitecore Search provided them REST API for us to do the content push, right? So basically, like this is some of the APIs which Sitecore Search provided for us. Like so this is an API. So this is an ingestion API. So this is our two information, important information, which is domain ID and customer key, customer ID. So I'm just gonna create a document in Sitecore. So this is my document which I'm trying to create. So this is a structure which we need to follow. ID is mandatory, and we can provide the fields here. Like again, this field should be already available in the attribute sections. Once I try to send this one, and this particular document will be created in Sitecore. So as I could see, this document is already been exist in the Sitecore set. That is what it's giving me this one. But yeah, if I try to put something like this one, it will try to insert into there. So now it is tied to inserter. It is inserting. And again, we have the similar way to update the document as well. Again, the same thing. Only thing is the post and the patch. We can do a patch as well, which is a partial update. Okay. And finally, we can even delete the document using the delete HTTP post. Okay. As you could see, the key is very important. This key is actually, as I told, I'm actually grabbing this key from the API access tab, which I'm grabbing from here. Okay, that's it. We don't want to create an access token for this one because this injection API will work directly by using this token, this key. We can grab this key and we can use this key here, and that's it. We can able to do a code operation over there. Okay, in case there is one more option, like if you want to see like the number of visitors who are coming to the website, like in the content tab, you could see there's the visitor information here. Okay, so if you want to see those visitors, like there is an API for us, like we can still use this API. And we can say these are all number of visitors available right now. So you could see my name there. So again, we can delete the visitors and something like that. And finally, I'll quickly show the local demo. All right, this one. So we, this is like our application looks like. Like when I use the GitHub project, like open source GitHub project, which is available from the Sitecore community, I just use this GitHub project, and I have integrated this GitHub project with the Sitecore search environment. So now this Git now. Basically, like this GitHub project will do all kind of search for me. So when I do this one, it will see by default, it is giving me all the suggestion, all the preview kind of a search widget for me. This is the preview widget. So when I do something like this one, so it is giving me the suggestions. Okay, I can still click this one, and it will take me to a details page like this one. Okay, I can still go with this search option. This is basically a sort option. This again we will be configuring in the Sitecore itself, which will be in the global widget itself. We have the sorting, the ranking, and the sorting we have. So we can still do that also in the attribute also. We can still do that on. Okay. Let's see something like, yeah, we can get all the data available here, right? So let me go one small thing here. So to tell you how the request goes, basically when I click this one. So you could see like this is exactly the request I'm passing, and see every click event when I'm trying to do all clicks event has been captured. Okay, so those event will be tracked in the Sitecore search itself. Like I click this particular thing, so something like it will track all this information. All this information will be tracked based on this user ID. So user ID will be generated dynamically for us. But yes, we can, if you are doing our own code, we can still generate our own user ID. So I can directly go to this place and content place, visitor, and I put this visitor ID here, and I could see like what exactly I'm browsing here. So basically like I just typed CTO right now. So this is what is coming up right here. And these are something I previously searched for it. Basically, yeah, we can still drill down to this data. Okay, so this kind of analytics. So once you go to the dashboard, and all the widget clicks I just did now, everything on the request I searched, everything will be tracked here. So this will give us the overall details for us. So event clicked, visitor interactions will be used for the personalization as well. So this will work based on your interaction with the search. So next time if you come, it will provide you the personalized suggestions for us to work with the search environment. That's it pretty much I did. Like this is something like how we gonna use the like so through API if I want to use a keyword search, right? So basically like this is how the query will be. So this query will be exactly passed here. If you go here, let me quickly clear this one. So show what I mean to say. CTO. This is payload, right? Okay. So you could see payload quickly. So you could see I just typed some words, so it's giving the key phrase here. It's under search, it's key phrases. So exactly this is what I'm trying to say. So whenever you're doing searching, the GitHub project is already created this kind of query for us. They're actually doing it, but still this we can still go and use our normal API to interact with the Sitecore search. Okay, so all this you can also see the suggestions here. If I want to use any recommendation thing, we can still go and use this one. If you want to use facet, and facets also very easy, we can just use this basically this one. If you want to show list all the facets, we can still you can just use this the kind of API query there. So as you could see, like I'm just crawling, the RFK ID is basically the widget ID. So from which widget you want to crawl this one? So all the search is based on the widget. So we need to specify the widget, then only the crawler will work. Okay. So again, you could see there's the content, everything. I think pretty much this is our sample GitHub repository, which is out of the box Sitecore community provided. So right now the one which you guys seeing is basically this one, the first one. Second one is purely a dev portal, which is sitecore.com. Based on this website, and the configuration for this one is pretty much easy. So basically we need to update the API key which we got. Okay, and finally we need to have a customer key and domain name. That's something which we already have, and this environment variable is very, very important. Basically, like I am using the European EU environment. So basically if you see my domain, it's EU, right? So it's EU region. So that is where I can't use prod here. So, but if you go to sitecore.com, it is they saying like discover.com something, okay? discover.sitecore.com.io, because they are using prod, but I'm using EU. So we have a different configuration. We have a different settings for all those things. Like this, all the information's available, like prod staging. I'm actually using prod EU for my configuration because my in the EU region. So we can update update accordingly. So once we did this one, it should work. So basically we need to provide a .env file and we need to update this information over there. I think that's it. So this is the configuration as of now I'm using. All right, any questions?
There is a question in chat, so just a second. I have disabled the audio settings for participants, but I can enable that now. Give me a second.
Okay.
You can unmute yourself now. Can you?
Let me stop sharing. Give me a second. I'm unmuted only. How can I do unmute?
Yeah, please try now.
Yeah, hi Nelson.
Hey, it's Remy.
Right here. So in our XP, right, we have options like profiling the content, and based on that individual visitor, we can set some personalization rules.
Yes.
So can we do such kind of things here so we can provide the personalized search results for individual users?
Yeah, so again, so basically here, when based on your visitor interactions, right? So you actually are doing based on a search and everything will be tracked for that particular user. Okay, so we have a personalization settings in Sitecore search. So only based on your interaction with the widgets and all those things, that it will provide you the suggestions. So I can quickly show the configuration right away. So where is Sitecore? So where is widget? Global widgets, sorry. So we have a personalization here, okay? So here, like we can see this is like more of like system will do personalization based, okay? Like we have we can't provide much information. Based it will try to take based on our interactions and everything. So basically it will try to create a strategy for us, like which attributes you want to take it from based on something like that. We can boost this one, something like that. Okay, so like not exactly like we're gonna do with CDP and something like that, but basically it will provide like based on your search keywords and how long you visited there. So based on that, it will create an algorithm and it will provide those informations to you based on the users. Okay, something like that only.
But we can't do like an individual for visitors, right? Something like we can set, or if we can set some items to pin, right, for particular user.
Okay, you are trying.
Page and we can show some item. Yeah.
No, you are trying to say the conditional based kind of thing, right? But yeah. As I told, so basically again, everything is based on the visitor only, right? So we have the visitor ID, right? So again, let me tell you. So any request you are passing to Sitecore, so everywhere you will be passing the visitor ID. Let me show quickly. Where is that one? So here, right? You see, any request you are passing, out of the box, we should pass the visitor information to us. Okay, let me do a small search here. If you go here, payload here. There is a payload. So you see, any request you pass, okay, we will always pass the visitor ID. So basically, how the Sitecore search will do, using this visitor ID, it will get the analytics information of that, what are the visitors' previous behavior and everything, and it will provide the suggestion for us, basically the suggestion and everything for us, okay? So this is basically how I interacted. So I will always be passing the visitor ID there.
Yeah, that is handled by that Sitecore, right? Sitecore search. But can we have any options like that? If particular user is coming, right, landing on their search bar, right? So I can ping one document for that, and we can first position or second position, something.
Okay, that's something we can do here. Okay, that I can show here. All right. So basically, this is something we can do in the blurring here widgets. Okay, in the widget level we can take an example of this widget. Okay, sorry, not this one. We have a blurring dog, all kind of features available here. Let's see. Okay, here. So here, say for an example, like right now what I did basically, I'm just providing this user only to show like the content is from the MVP source only. Okay, I still want to show, I can still blacklist like some of the item I don't want. Ignore this. Say for an example, I don't want this item, right? I can still ignore this item as a blacklisted item, so that will item never gonna show to that user. Okay, something like that. We can still do the configuration here. Okay, yeah, I can boost the results to the top one. So always, if I want one result to become always the top, that particular item I can still make sure it goes in the top. So based on any information, like based on a title or anything, we can provide those information. That particular information will provide comes in the top. I hope this provides information.
Yeah. Yeah, I got it. Thanks for the information.
As for now, my current thing is actually using the same thing only. Basically, if you search anything, my album will always come in the first, basically. So you see there's a facet coming up here, right? See, this is how the facet will work right now.
Yeah.
Like I can search like this one and it will give like this information. If I remove this one, and it will go. So this is again the facet based thing. We can still configure all those things. Background, it will try to query the facet is recommendation API. Sorry, yeah.
And for the UI perspective, right? If I want to change something in this look and feels, right? Then So it's out of the box available in React or means in which content technology?
So basically, like they provided three options for us. Okay, one is like a JS data package, which I'm not explored much. Which is again a JavaScript. Any JavaScript framework, they're saying like any JavaScript framework can be used for that one, and they have a specific React SDK, and they used normal for developers like us. They're actually using like REST APIs, like all API based thing. So if you want to have full control, we can go with API based. But the recommendation is like going with SDK only, which is React, which is all the components already readily available. We just need to see this. Just the three lines of code I just updated. Okay, basically this. Once I did this one, like the entire application starts works for me. The three lines of configuration. But if I want to go with React API, normal REST API or something, then I need to do wrapper code or something like that. Then I need to pass it to the front end team. The front end team has to create the UI which they want to show. Yeah. But yeah, we can still customize this UI. This is basically a style sheet and all the themings, right? That's something we can still customize using React and something. But yeah, if you want full control, we can go with the API as well.
Okay, thanks.
I think that's it, right?
Yes.
Okay. In that case, thank you everyone for joining. Thanks for the opportunity, Kushbu, for speaking in Sukin.
Yeah, always welcome. Thank you. I'll share the recording on YouTube so everyone can refer from that.
Thank you. Bye bye.
Thank you. Thank you for joining.
Thanks.